such a diversity, different religion, different race, different languages, but somehow everybody hangs together. And that's why we need to keep that in focus in every part of our programs. So as a result of our conversation with Obama, Mr. Obama, we decided to launch a joint program between the US and India. We took 15 people from our team, 15 from White House, and built open government platform. It's already announced. I was in Washington in August or so. Hillary Clinton and all of us were together and we announced this platform. This platform is now going to be available to all countries free of charge, open source, developed jointly by US and India, to really open up their government to radicalize their democracies. The idea is to really basically democratize information. Information is power, not many people like to share. And we believe for us to push democracies, we need to really radicalize information infrastructure. So we have two major networks that we are building. One called National Knowledge Network to connect 1,500 nodes with 40 gigabit bandwidth to connect all our universities, all our libraries, all our R&D institutions in India. That network is connected to US with optical fiber. So US universities can interact with Indian universities. It is connected to EU and it is connected to Japan. So I can listen to a professor from University of Chicago and broadcast to 5,000 colleges in India today. It cost us $3 billion. It's all built, it's working today. But people don't know how to use it. They have no idea, what do you do with all this bandwidth? So one day I decided to find out, because I also don't know what to do with 40 gigabit bandwidth every day. So I talked to a friend of mine at Stanford University. He's a physicist. And he said, Sam, I use 40 gigabit bandwidth every day, 24 hours a day, between Stanford and Europe. So there are scientists who know how to use these things. We are beginning to learn to use these kind of highways. All set up. Second network we are building at the cost of $6 billion is to connect 250,000 local governments to optical fiber. It's already underway. It will be all built in the next 18 months. We have mapped every little fiber in the country. We have 1 million kilometers of fiber. And we are adding 400,000 kilometers more for last mile connectivity. When that happens, every local government will have hundreds of megabits of bandwidth coming in. But people say, well, you don't have water, you don't have education, what do you do with optical fiber? That's the challenge. The idea is keep doing it and something will happen. If you have answers to everything, nothing will happen. I must give credit to the government that they have been able to put political will behind it. And without political will, these kinds of things cannot be done. So along with these two networks, NKN and optical fiber network, we have a program to identify and tag every resident in the country. 1 billion people are being given unique ID with fingerprints, iris, photograph. That program is underway. We have 200 million already documented. And by end of December 2013, 690 million will be documented. Massive program. The idea is to tag every human being. And there is logic to it. Then we have another program called National GIS. To tag every physical asset. The UID is going to cost us about $3-4 billion. GIS will cost us about another $2 billion. Where we want every physical space, because today in India we have lots of maps. Water department has their own map, power department has their own map, revenue department have their map, everybody is doing their own thing. So we said, stop it. We need one set of maps. So we had 30 departments come together, fight for a while, and after 18 months everybody got convinced that we need one map. So we are working on National GIS program. Then we have cybersecurity platform, application platform, payment platform, data centers. We are setting up massive data centers, 4 main data centers in the country, Delhi, Pune, Hyderabad, and Bhubaneswar. Every state will have their own data center as well. All of it is on open source. And applications that we work on relate to food distribution, employment guarantee scheme programs, driver's license, passports, income tax, land record. These are all major verticals. And today we have 10,000 software people working in the government on all of these programs. When you put all this together, it's going to cost us about $20 billion now. And most of it will be done, hopefully, in the next 24 months. When this gets done, you create whole new opportunities for young. So take, for example, education. There is no way we can take US model and scale it. I've been saying to the rest of the world now that the US model of development based on consumption is not scalable, sustainable, desirable. It worked well for 300 million when 300 million could hog all of the world resources. When you have 3 billion more, billion from India, billion from China, billion from Soviet Union, you can't do it. World just doesn't have enough resources to have the kind of model that we have created. Can you imagine 1.2 billion cars in India? If you take the US model, can you imagine 1.5 billion cars in China? What does it mean to the world? Same way the education. We cannot have $30,000 a year tuition. This model is based on student-teacher ratio of 10 to 1, massive infrastructure of classrooms, libraries, football field, great buildings. Can't do it. So we are saying, let's redefine the model of education. Today, teacher is required to deliver content and create content. I don't need teacher to create content, because content is created by best of the best in the world. If a Nobel laureate in physics creates content at Harvard or MIT, my guy in India is not going to add much value. He may think he's going to. So take the best content available from everywhere in the world. Then I don't need teacher to deliver content. He's not going to take duster and blackboard and write on the board. I don't need it. Then what do I need teacher for? When I say this, teachers' unions react. And then you know you're on right track. So we are saying we need to redefine the role of the teacher to that of a mentor. But none of these teachers are trained to be mentored. So we got to redo the whole process. We need to tell teacher you are no longer a teacher. You don't need to teach. You need to mentor. You need to give kids comfort, love, affection, understand your kids. You don't need to know about too much physics, because there's an expert sitting somewhere in other part of the world who is the best of the best. So kids would learn from the guru. Peter Drucker will teach them management, though he is no longer here. So local professor doesn't need to worry about management teaching. What does he know? Now, this is a new model, and people react to it. Take, for example, health. I cannot have the kind of hospitals we are building in this country with MRI and, you know, all these X-ray machines and fancy 5-star hotel rooms. Can't do it, because you cannot scale that. for 1.2 billion. So what do I need? I need on my mobile phone health record. I need telemedicine. I need low-cost generic drugs. I need traditional medicine connected to modern medicine. I always give this example that my mother delivered 8 kids in a small little village where there was no running water, no electricity, no doctor, no pharmacy, no nurse, no telephone. All 8 out of 8 turned out to be mentally healthy, physically healthy. They must have done something right. What was it? We have forgotten. All 8 came to America. All 8 are settled here and doing very well. I think we have forgotten the traditional knowledge. We have lost track of all the wisdom that our great grandparents had. And we immediately jump onto the modern $10,000 for delivery cost. And we are saying, wait a minute, you can't do these things. So just don't blindly copy Western model. And that's what the whole world is doing today. And we are saying health delivery has to change, education has to change, governance has to change, agricultural practices have to change. And in many of these areas, you need to go back to your roots, because local ecosystems matter. Don't complicate local ecosystem. All of this is tough task, because not many people see this through. It's easy to see something that's already there in the US and say, easy to copy. And that's what is going on in the rest of the world. Everybody wants to copy this model. So during Thanksgiving, if US retail sales are higher, everybody all over the world is happy. Guy in China, Korea, India is very happy. I mean, it's just dumb. But that's the way the world works. And here we have created all these standards of GDP, GNP, per capita income, foreign exchange reserve. I'm saying these things don't make sense anymore. It was okay when you had one dominated power. Now, when I look back and see what happened after World War, US decided, handful of 5 guys in the US decided to structure the world. World Bank, IMF, UN, you know, NATO, WIPO, everything was done by 5 guys. And that was really designed to create a whole new world. And that world don't make sense in 21st century. We need to redesign the world. 21st century is all about creating equality, prosperity for everybody, not for few. New technology, new tools. And we really need to create a new world. How do we do that? And that requires focus on using new technology, whether it is IT, biotech, nanotech, materials, alternate energy, to really change business models everywhere. Old business models don't make sense. We can't be thinking of 20th century knowledge and hoping to deliver solutions for the 21st century needs. And that's where I think there is disconnect all over the world. Everybody is still locked up in the past. They all want to go back to what it was, as opposed to saying, you can't go back to what it was. You got to go forward. And that's a tough choice, because what it was, we know how it is. In the future, we don't know how it is going to be. And that's the challenge I see everywhere. Just to give another idea, I have a couple of minutes.